nigga ain't no Max 10. He's a 22, I seen you, Max. You ain't say shit
in. And the crowd just gave me super love.
Eventually, Common performed The Bitchin' You in Los Angeles, boldly dissing Ice Cube in his own city.
Oh, man, I don't know what's gonna jump off. It's like, I just was feeling the fury to a certain extent because it was just, I felt like Ice Cube then was wrongly accusing me, so I was on the defensive at that point. Plus, I knew the verse was lighting the crowd up, too.
On the dick of the East for your first release, huh? Your lease is up at the crib house, niggas get evicted. And videos are white.
I thought that shit was whack. You know, because Common ain't even a rah-rah type nigga. You know? And, come on, Common.
I didn't know what it was gonna escalate to. I didn't know. I was, like, prepared for anything.
When I'm calling out, I break it as smack.
Niggas,
you send it to all the house, sick of me. Come on, let's come to sell it. Oh, I put shot sky. Niggas can't cut.
Shit was getting out of hand. It was getting completely the fuck out of hand, for real.
By the mid-90s, West Coast artists grew impatient with the New York bias against their work.
And we changed the rap.
Mercedes-Benz built a car. I'm driving one. He ain't gonna get mad at me for driving it, is he? So what, you started it? I'ma finish it. Period.
With Dr. Dre's The Chronic, an entire coast demanded respect.
Bow Down was the number one motherfucking record in the country. And we didn't have no spins on the East Coast radio station.
As West Coast record sales soared, the East Coast felt something they had never felt before. Jealousy.
Snoop and them had came out with a song called, you know what I mean, New York, New York. And they was kicking over our buildings in the videos and whatnot. And we had like took that like kind of personal, you know what I'm saying? Kicking over our buildings, you know what I'm saying?
We not finna even get put in that point where we say fuck the East Coast, cause there's money over there, man. So it's like New York is the spot. New York, New York.
They like fuck the dog pound right now.
So we had to go back at them, you know what I'm saying? We made a song called LA, LA.
LA, LA, big city of dreams, but everything in LA ain't always what it seems. You might get fooled if
you're the only niggas that at that time they came out and firmly stood up for NY at that time, you know what I'm saying? Go back, check the records, and you will hear
Tragedy, Mobb Deep.
Right, video for it and all that.
Cause we coming from Queens, it gets down.
Well, the East Coast, West Coast thing got big because it sold records, you know what I mean? Because it sold magazines, because it helped ratings for TV and radio. I mean, a lot of it was about money as far as I'm concerned.
The media.
All right. The media sees the so-called East Coast, West Coast war, keeping a curious audience current with blow-by-blow coverage. Many non-related events and grievances were attributed to the beef, and sensational coverage by magazines, radio stations, and television made artists, labels, and fans take sides.
Suspiciously immediately following Shakur's shooting in New York on November 7th.
Fueled the growing East Coast versus West Coast battle.
The reported threats on Combs' life.
Suge Knight strikes a towering pose.
Couldn't help but notice the huge biceps itching to bust through his shirt.
Heard there was a contract out on my life, said Combs.
West Coast.
Yeah, the Goodfellas thing was definitely purposeful. The whole Mafia reference was definitely purposeful because at this point, Death Row was the most feared entity in the music industry. And we loved the fact that these cats agreed to pose in these black outfits. We thought it was hot, you know what I'm saying? Death Row Records had a publicist named George Price at the time. And in the middle of us laying out the cover, George Price calls and he says, whatever you do, make sure the letters on the cover are in red. You know what I'm saying?
I've had plenty of problems with people that live on my block. They ain't start no whole Brooklyn thing like this, East, like Bed-Stuy against Brownsville. They ain't start no whole big thing like that.
Controversy sells.
The rappers didn't take it to another level. The companies took it to another level.
My whole career was never, I had never been in an interview where they didn't ask me about East Coast, West Coast. East Coast, West Coast beef.
Ain't no real East Coast, West Coast beef.
Oh, you don't like Hammer. You don't like Will Smith. You know, just let's just get you to say you don't like somebody.
You could be, you know, artists from wherever, from Wyoming, and they're gonna ask you, well, how do you feel about what's going on with such and such and such and such?
What about Eazy-E?
Sir, are you happy at Death Row Records now?
But I ain't get on the camera to talk about that.
The interview nigga asked me a question about it in the magazine. He was like, yo, I heard boom, boom, you wasn't feeling with Jay-Z. I was like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? I think you're a bitch-ass nigga for saying that, you know what I'm saying?
Come on, come on.
Now, when you make a statement, it's in the paper, you've taken a stance.
Bottom line, fuck that fat bitch.
When you're new in the game, you got an open mouth and you're not aware of the game they're playing with you. And you may open your mouth and say something about somebody that you didn't have to.
Fuck the source, all right? Source can suck a dick. Fuck them motherfuckers.
Can we say fuck Tim Dog on TV?
Say it. Fuck Tim Dog.
When you read your article, that's the piece that's blown up. That's in the big letters. You're like, oh!
And the stories kept coming. Rumors that Tupac had sex with Biggie Small's wife. That Tupac Shakur had been raped in prison. That Puffy had something to do with the death of Jake Robles, Suge Knight's close friend. March 1996. A gun is drawn as Death Row and Bad Boy square off at the Soul Train Awards in Los Angeles. As the tensions rose, the game's two premier MCs became opposing generals in hip-hop's civil war, whether they liked it or not.
Here we are, you know, with this magazine. We know in the magazine world, even if something says September, it generally comes out like the month before, around the middle of the month before. And so, East Coast, West Coast, by September 13th, Tupac is dead. You know, 6 months later, Biggie's dead. And so this cover is actually kind of eerie, you know what I'm saying?
When you see a Vibe magazine, when you see Puff and Biggie on the cover and see East vs. West, niggas in the hood don't read articles. They just see East vs. West. Oh, it's on.
It's on.
When I see them niggas, it's on.
I think Vibe gets a lot of heat for that one, because it was such a, you remember that, what that cover looked like. And I think a lot of the people who probably worked at Vibe at that time still to this day feel kind of like, you know, but Vibe wasn't the only people calling that beef that. Everybody was.
It was crazy. It was just a crazy time. And I might say now, you know, I regret the media's role and stuff like this, but we really didn't realize how deep we were into this. Most, I mean, if I'm only in my 30s now, I was in my 20s like most of us, you know what I'm saying? We were all kids documenting this thing. We're not even clear who we are, and we're dealing with this dominant youth culture of the day, and it's taking this very violent turn. This thing called East Coast, West Coast, we've never seen anything like this before. And we're just literally swept into it. It was insane, you know? There was no way to know where it was going, no way.
You know, like with the Biggie and Tupac battle, you know, there was a lot of people that was not checking to see if Pac could outrun Biggie. They were checking to see who could win in a physical confrontation, whose camps could win if the two met up with one another.
As the business of rap music became increasingly like the streets, the artists' crews, made up of close friends, family, and up-and-coming artists, became increasingly part of the problem. They were there to stop.
I mean, I've dealt with a whole lot of people that involved themselves in the streets and brought the streets into the game. And it's like the problem with that is when you bring the streets into the game, they only know the rules of the streets.
I got family, and I got a big family. No one of them dudes, you know what I'm saying, who just had a real big family. I have an extra huge family. But even the cops get that confused. Like, you know what I'm saying, the cops start thinking we're a gang and we're this, and they don't understand I just make music. And you know what I mean? These dudes just support me a whole lot. Some of these dudes just support me from the street, and they living this life.
Most rap crews are made up of, I say, 50% businessmen and 50% thugs. 50% of your crew is made up of homeboys that just came home from jail. Now, my boys that just got out, I've been the guy on their TV that they've been pointing at. That's my man. That's my man. When they get home, their life is based around maybe I could roll with Ice. Maybe Ice could help me, you know? Now, what can he do? What can he actually do? But say, yo, Blow, Joe Blow is dissing you and I knocked him out in the club. What can he do? So then that thug element is always ready to reach out and touch anybody, whether it's a cameraman, whether it's an interviewer, whether it's somebody on the radio. They do not have any other way of showing the rapper that they man than busting somebody in their head. And that's where they get their stripes. So you gotta understand that thug element is always available in rap.
You know, they want them stripes. They want them points. So it's like, even though you might tell a person, look, I really need you to slow down and cease fire this and that. Hey, he's a grown man. When you're not around, he might just come along anyway and just, you know, do what he want to do on his own.
Then, instead of fighting me like a G, he ran. Now, I can't help it if some niggas that was on the scene beat his ass for running. That was something separate, you understand me? And I can't help it if they were screaming thug life as they did it. That ain't my fault. That's just how shit went down, you understand me?
I could not be there, but if I have this person running around with me to the point that you would start associating him with me, and he decides to just go kill a nigga while I'm off doing some other shit, they gonna say I sent that.
I've been in situations where I've been with my boys and I'm talking to a friend of mine in hip hop, but his soldiers is sizing up my soldiers. You see what I'm saying? His man just came out looking at my man crazy. I'm walking down the street, my man's like, I don't like it, boy. I'm like, you shut, that's my man. But that's they animal. That's how they rationalize things with combat.
So when you first come out of the hood, you come out of the hood and you were a drug dealer and your friends is drug dealers and your friends is thugs and you were just a poet that hung out with thugs and you might have been thug too and you got a record. People around you are very protective. They're very violent. They don't really believe they have nothing to live for. And you are the centerpiece of their lives and, you know, and you're trying to train them as you learn. It's tough.
I mean, Snoop got people that's loyal to him that will probably kill you before he would.
But you gotta know how to separate your friends from your homies, from your loved ones. I mean, it's, you got homeboys, you got friends, and you got dogs. My dogs is with me all the time. My friends, hey, what's happening, local art? I get back at you. And my homeboys is people who I got love for, but they don't understand this business right now, so I have to keep them to a limit.
It was times where I had concerts and shows, and I tell a couple people to meet me on my block, on my corner when I first got signed. And before I know it, I look up, it's like a parade outside.
There's always somebody in somebody's ear, like telling you, fuck that, B. Just that and third.
Yo, did that nigga go right there?
That nigga said this, man.
Why you don't go see him?
Because nowadays, I mean, the pressure from your man's to make you go hurt something.
That's the dude you need to get away from you. Or you got to school him quick because he don't know no better.
In 1995, a crew from Eazy-E's Ruthless Records visited the Dog Pound on the set of a music video. The Dog Pound, because of their allegiance to Death Row Records, were drawn into Dr. Dre's ongoing beef with Eazy-E.
Actually, Eazy-E boys, they was just, I mean, me and Ricky Harris was riding around, you know, on a little go-kart thing, getting ready to shoot a scene, and they just walked up on me like, fuck the Dog Pound, you know what I mean? And my response is like, I mean, I'm not, it's about 100 people around, and one of them went behind me. So I'm like, well, either I swing now, or else I just get swung on, so. It's Eazy-E, rest in peace. I don't know how much he had to do with influencing them to talk about us. But that they was down with him and we was down with Dre, so they was trying to do their diss thing. And we not trying to be no hooligans, we out here trying to make money, because I know that day I felt real bad about what
they for 8 months.
It looked real silly.
I love this game.
Fatal Hussein of the Outlaws was part of Tupac Shakur's crew. Due to a court date on the East Coast, Fatal wasn't in Las Vegas the night Tupac was shot.
Not that I'm some kind of, you know, gladiator or nothing like that, but if I was dead, I know, you know, know, I'm in the streets, basically. Only time I'm not in the streets is when I'm with Tupac. So I know right from wrong. I know, you know, this shit is still a street. And I know it's certain things you can do and certain things you can't do, man, especially when you at that level, when it's like people that was around him at the time wasn't feeding this to him, man.
After a Mike Tyson bout, Tupac Shakur started a fight with Orlando Anderson, a Los Angeles gang member. Several hours later, Shakur was shot in a car just off the Las Vegas Strip.
I never stopped thinking about what the fuck was Tupac doing out there rolling in the dirt with a nigga that he ain't had no business even. He shouldn't even gave that nigga the time, man, to even say some shit like, yeah, me and Pac had a fight, man. It was like 100 other niggas there. It was supposed to be people there that was supposed to step up and handle situations. Niggas wasn't around just to be rapping and eating up shit and messing with chicks and shit like that. Everybody in the crew got a part to play. And if you don't play your part, then it's all gonna crumble. And if they get the head, man, what's gonna happen to the body? I felt like if I was there, shit would have been totally different, man.
After the deaths of Tupac Shakur and Biggie Smalls, artists and the media temporarily came to their senses.
If you know that it's arousing the whole community, you know that you don't want that to happen. You don't want that energy coming your way, then it's definitely like up to you to take a stand and be like, yo, I really have no ill feelings towards you as a person. This was me expressing myself through my art. It's love. I want to see you prosper too. I mean, I think a lot of the artists feel that way. They might not say it all the time. Because cats, you know, do get emotional. Sometimes it does become personal. But overall, I know the nature of these cats ain't about, like, I want to see this dude dead.
In 1997, Minister Farrakhan called an intervention in Chicago in an attempt to resolve disputes peacefully. Minister Farrakhan told his guests about organized techniques white slave owners had used to keep slaves slaves, including deliberately causing, developing, and maintaining hostility amongst them.
Ice Cube flew in, Mac 10 flew in, Ice Cube came and just gave me a hug.
When I met Common just kind of felt like he had to defend himself because he a cool dude, actually. And Common good, man. He can rap. He do what he do.
And I needed that, the elders to come bring us together and just be able to sit us at the table where it wouldn't be no ignorance and no homies just sitting around talking crazy. And we get aroused and just had a peace treaty. And we hugged, you know, so it was like, I needed that.
We got close, but then she broke to the West Coast, and I was cool, because around the same time, I went away.
Because they have the respect of many artists, outside entities like the Nation of Islam and Zulu Nation, as well as individuals like Russell Simmons, Jim Brown, and Mike Conception, have led the way in squashing beefs in hip-hop.
In the Nation of Islam, I'm not even allowed to speak negative of another member to another individual in the nation unless the one of whom I'm speaking about is present. If I go to another member about something negative about another member, that member is to stop me and said, hold up. If it ain't positive, I don't want to hear it. And if it's negative, that other person is not here. So what I do then, I go to someone who can officiate my beef, and I want to witness that I tried to settle it. So I don't fear nobody but God. I don't have to go and slander you behind your back. I think that's a coward's way out. Sometimes the other artist didn't even realize you had a problem with him until he heard your record. See, that's a punk way of doing things to me. That's not being a man or a woman. You should have called that artist and faced him with arbitrators saying, you did this to hurt me, and allow that person to say, I'm sorry, I didn't know what I did affected you this way. Would you please accept my apology?
We have a hip-hop summit here. We have people that work all day long on settling beefs. You know, I've been lucky enough to have an opportunity to influence some of these people. And if someone listens to me, then I should use my influence best I can. I pay for a lot of this shit myself. I don't expect to get any help from the people who own the record companies. I wish they'd help me underwrite the hip-hop summit, because they're making billions of dollars. I don't think that people give a shit. Sometimes I don't even think they care if the artist dies, as long as the catalog sells.
so
despite the wake-up call of Biggie Smalls and Tupac Shakur's murders, as well as the efforts of many to reconcile out-of-control beefs, the climate in hip-hop grew increasingly hostile in the late 90s. Beef and diss records sprung from all over the place, in greater numbers than ever before. With big money at stake, lyrics became increasingly violent and personal. Everyone got involved, including hip-hop's premier MC.
Take over, the break's over, nigga.
No, you ain't talking about me, dog. You? What?
Fuck Jay-Z.
Nasty Nas, the Eskos trash. Had a spark when you started, but now you're just garbage.
How can I be garbage?
Just switch up your flow, your shit is garbage. Just try and kick knowledge.
Big dick sucking lips. Won't you let the late great veteran lip?
Since you infatuated with saying that gay shit, yeah, she was kissing my dick when you was kissing that bitch.
KRS already made an album called Blueprint First.
Fell from top 10 to not mention at all. To your bodyguards, Uzi Wally's verse better than yours.
You show off, I count Dolph when you sample my voice.
Oh yeah, I sampled your voice. You was using it wrong. You made it a hot line. I made it a hot song.
That this Jay-Z and Cockefeller Records wanted beef.
Look, I got more shooters in Queensbridge than you.
88, you was getting chased to your building. Call it my crib and I ain't even give you my numbers.
I came in your belly backseat.
A fan, a phony, a fake, a pussy.
Skeeted in your Jeep, left condoms on your baby seat.
That ether, that shit that make your soul burn slow. Put it together, I rock hoes, y'all rock fellas. And now y'all trying to take my spot, fellas.
Because it stayed on wax, the beef between Jay-Z and Nas elevated the entire game.
Put it on wax, you get out there, you do your damn thing.
Jay-Z and Nas has both been around a long time. They both lived through Biggie and Tupac. And so I think they're smarter than that. And so they resolved their beef. You know, I put it all on record. They're a little more experienced, a little more worldly. And they realize how their labor affects so many people. Nas feeds a lot of people. Jay-Z is responsible to a lot of people that he came up with.
If you got a beef with somebody and you really think you got to disrespect them, you're going to have to deal with the consequences later. Because niggas is from the street, yo. Niggas is straight off the bricks. Niggas is feeding their families, yo. And it's serious. That's like on the streets, if you roll up on somebody, you disrespect them, for them to stay in the streets, they got to handle you. Or the streets going to handle them. If you ain't prepared for the aftermath, don't come up in there with none of that bullshit, period. Because it will get dealt with, whether it's the artist or they people. Be real with yourself. Be real. If you got talent, you ain't got to diss nobody else. And if you're going to diss somebody, you know what the repercussions can be, so you ready for it. And you better be ready for it, because it's going to come.
They call us the mall because we deep. We mad deep. They call us the infamous because of how we get down.
Anybody else that want drama, come see us, man. Come right here, man. We be right out here. If you want drama with us, we right here, son.
Word. Chill, baby.
Never stop. The war is on 24-7. Make no mistakes about it. We ready for this. We been doing this. Niggas know. Check the track record. What, nigga?
Don't promote it. And if you're gon' spit it out, make sure you wrote it. Ooh. And if you're gon' cross us, make sure you're holding. Cause it'll be more than just niggas with they face
moving.
It's S to the I and T-R-U. We mean business. Knocking on doors like Jehovah Witness.
Ooh.
How y'all call yourselves murderers when we the killers, nigga?
Oh, shit.
Yeah, I don't want to get into that, no names, but nothing happened, though. You know what I'm saying?
While most beefs increasingly seem inspired by the desire for record sales and media drama, there are some beefs that remain underground.
Mobb Deep incident, man. We had did a record together. Me, Prodigy, and Kool G Rap. You know what I'm saying? Shit came out of eye. You know what I mean? We had a little...
was going with the record, and the nigga played himself and spit the verse on another record, you know what I'm saying? Guess he wasn't that talented, and went and spit the verse on another record when we paid him for that verse already, so we ended up getting to a little controversy. He treated me like I was some funny style nigga. I tried to holler, he played games, so I had to wake him up, let him know what I was about, you know what I mean?
Prodigy of Mobb Deep appeared on the soundtrack with Tru Life. Before it could be released, Prodigy recorded his verse on a song that appeared on the Any Given Sunday soundtrack, leaving Tru Life unable to release his track.
Let's talk about the Tru Life incident. What was the Tru Life incident?
Tru Life incident?
Tru Life?
Oh, they talk about Hobie, that Puerto Rican kid.
Who?
From the LES, from the Lower East Side.
Oh, all right.
His name is Tru Life.
Oh, the incident with us and him? All right.
We're not even gonna talk about that, man. That's totally out the whole tape. You could erase that, bro.
I was in the studio with Jizza from Wu-Tang, and I had some other friends that came down and visited me, whatever, and they was there, and we're chilling. The music's loud as fuck, dog. We can't even hear. We're like this, popping. All of a sudden, my boy walks to the door, and he's like this.
You know, we ended up taking it there. Man ran in the studio with 9 guns, two shotguns.
7 motherfuckers running with Uzis and shotguns and fucking guns.
You know, slapped a few cats up.
These other kid over here, they pistol whipped him.
Sent the nigga home butt naked and all that.
Kicked the shit out of him.
Showed him how we do this, man. We ain't playing no games
with
niggas. They didn't even look at me. They didn't even look at Jizza, you know what I mean?
A few of your favorite rappers was in there, you know what I mean? At gunpoint with guns to their face and shit. But it ain't nothing, you know what I'm saying? There wasn't no drama with them. We ain't want to just get out of hand like we was wilding for no reason. We wilding for a reason, man. You fuck with us, man, you know what I mean?
True story, man. True story.
We gonna wild out on you, you know what I mean? You bring it to us, we gonna bring it to y'all, you know what I'm saying? That's how we coming, fam. Real tizzle, man. We ain't playing with this.
And Dito,
I got good aim, y'all.
I got good aim. It's nothing.
The gun went off and just missed them. And they robbed them all and shit. Took all their clothes off and dipped.
$1 for a stripper.
Did you get the results that you wanted to get?
Did I get the results? Not really, man, tell you the truth, you know what I'm saying? Because really, I thought the nigga was a street cat, you know what I'm saying? So it's like niggas be talking this gangster shit on records, how they handling shit and all that, like niggas is G'd up and all that, so we took it there. But niggas really wasn't ready, and it seemed like, you know what I mean, niggas got scared of me and all that. And that's not what we trying to do, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, we gonna bring it there if we gotta bring it there, you know what I mean? You fuck around, you gonna lay around, homie, be doing this for real, man, we G'd up for real, you know what I'm saying?
It's the Hey, yo, I treat niggas like bitches, kid. Want a strip for me?
$1 fight.
Strip for me, $1. Tru Life, yo. Tru Life, yo. That's word.
Prodigy and Havoc were not present when Tru Life confronted Mobb Deep at the studio, but felt responsible for their group that bore the brunt of Tru Life's response.
Where do it stop? You know what I mean? Like, how far do it go? Eventually, somebody could fuck around and die behind it. And then at the end of the day, you think about it, is it all worth it? When it's just supposed to be music.
Could Prodigy have realized how important the collaboration track was to a signed but unreleased artist like Tru Life?
I was ready to shoot a low budget video to it, put out some vinyl, like a little single to start my little career.
Could Prodigy have responded when Tru Life tried to bring the issue to him?
I made the phone call. I made more than one phone call. I was calling these kids for over a month, 2 months. You know what I'm saying? I'm calling everybody. I'm calling their manager. I got my manager calling. I got this one calling, that one calling. And you know, they was just showing me no respect.
Could Tru Life have responded in a diss record in a way that was hip-hop? Or did he mistake Mobb Deep's gangster lyrics for an invitation to deal with the beef in a street way?
Sometimes being a man, part of being a man is learning how to swallow your pride. And I guess that's one time that I slipped, and men make mistakes. You know, we're human beings. And I slipped and I made a mistake, and I didn't swallow my pride that time. My pride got to me, and it was too big. I kind of almost choked on it. It was like I was willing to die for my pride at that situation. I'm more grown now. I got a son now, and I look at things way differently, and I see things way differently. And looking at myself, looking back on the videotape, I kind of look a little ignorant to myself, just looking at myself like, you know what I mean? Because I know that ain't me, that's not the man I want to be.
Fortunately, this beef has since been squashed privately. 20 years since Kool Moe Dee and Busy B, the competitive landscape has changed considerably. Battles, disses, beefs, and deaths have molded the character of MCs along the way. Today, hip-hop is facing a new generation of MCs. A generation of MCs that might not know where music ends and the streets begin. A generation raised on beef. Cent embodies the new battle MC, a drug dealer from the streets of Queens who made his name and built his fame by beefing with other artists. But as recently as 1999, 50 Cent was just one of thousands of young MCs trying to beat the odds.
My favorite friend and my favorite rapper in the whole world, drop his album, please. Thank you.
Being a new kid, brand new, nobody don't know nobody, how do you get in all at one time? You make everybody that you feel like is somebody go, who's 50 Cent?
Bottom line is, I'm a cool to the end.
Since hip-hop started, an up-and-coming MC could attack an established artist to get in the game. But 50 Cent's How to Rob marked a new phenomenon, an MC dissing dozens of artists who took his threats seriously and his disses personally.
I don't give a fuck today about that, because I'm facing those same situations in my hood all day. So if they got a problem and they want to go the other route with it, it's the same deal. You know, because it's that or go back to the hood, and that's all that's waiting for me back in the hood.
I'm about to pick Bobby for some of them.
But more importantly, you get the attention of a superstar.
What figure just sold like 4 million? Got something to live for. Don't want a nigga putting four through that Bentley coupe door.
I ran into Jay at Summer Jam.
So they're backstage and Jay was like,
yo, I don't like that record you got. I love that record you got.
The song was hot. 50 was like, you know, good looking. He's like, but you know, I gotta get you.
I'm like, all right, you know, do what you do. I didn't know he meant right then. He go on stage, that's the first time I ever seen 30,000 people. He said, I'm about a dollar, who the fuck is 50 Cent?
I'm about dollars, who the fuck is 50 Cent?
I didn't even know 30,000 people knew who 50 Cent was. I should send him a bottle of champagne for that.
In April 2000, 50 Cent was shot 9 times with a 9mm handgun as he left his grandmother's house in Queens.
This gun's still going off. You jumping around in the backseat of the fucking car and shit. You don't know whether you're gonna get up out this bitch or not, man. You know what I'm saying? And then you in the rearview mirror looking at you. You got a hole in your face. You don't know if you gonna, if that bullet is gonna kill you. Still, when it might not kill you right now while you're on your way to the hospital, but you don't know if it can be removed without killing you. And getting shot changed me a lot. I don't care about shit no more. Well, you can say I'm worse, because I really don't give a fuck. Now it's more like I know that I'm not in control of everything. You know, if you believe in God, you believe God got a plan for you, and that you're not in control over that plan.
Armed with his fatalistic attitude, 50 Cent set his sights on his greatest challenge.
This
we went down with that cat 50 Cent. We went down with that.
Who?
That cat 50 Cent.
Who? I don't know him. You know what I'm saying? I don't even know what you're talking about.
From adjacent neighborhoods in Queens, the beef between 50 Cent and Ja Rule started in the streets in 1999.
A friend of mine's robbed Ja Rule. And I'm in a club, and I see the nigga. I'm like, hey, what's up? You know, I'm chilling. He see me kicking it with the nigga that robbed him. And he feel like, oh shit, I shouldn't speak to this dude because I know the kid robbed him, but I know this kid, I grew up with him.
Next, words are exchanged and blows thrown as the two square off in Atlanta. And from there, things turned ugly.
So yo, 50, what's the definition of a wankster, man? I mean, what is that?
Ja Rule, Irv Gotti.
I'll tell you personally, the murder ain't the people that you see, like Irv, Ja, the people that are involved in the business aspect are bitches. Like, these niggas don't got no hood in them.
He's nobody. He's this person. Right, this person we're talking about, he's no one.
That's the whole wankster thing.
Some niggas ain't hustlers.
Exactly.
See what I'm saying? So when you got a nigga that's not a hustler, he becomes a buddy hustler. And what he does is he tries to eat off of other niggas' plates.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying? By, you know, mentioning names and saying things.
Come on, give me a kiss, you little faggot.
And then wanting them to chant back. So that's why, you know, when you say the name, I say who?
That nigga's a sweetheart, for real.
I don't know him.
He's a fruit pop, for real.
You know, he sells, like, no records. He's not even came out yet.
I can't even see how a kid could look at Ja Rule and want to be like Ja Rule.
I don't know him.
This nigga want to be Tupac Shakur.
There's a lot of people out there that don't have things.
This nigga doing duets.
That see people with things.
But you call yourself a murderer the whole time.
And they want what these other people got.
Right. He's a pop artist.
Who?
Grease Video.
Buddy Hustler.
Like, you might as well just go over there and hang out with Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears and them if they'll accept you.
Success is the best, you know what I mean? Revenge, nigga.
That shit is crazy. I really don't like that guy. I really don't like Ja Rule.
Make a nigga die bleeding is nothing. You make a nigga die breathing and you're saying something.
Maybe I'm so disrespectful because to me you're a mystery. I know niggas from your hood. You have no history. Never poke nothing, never pop nothing. Nigga, stop fronting.
That's his personal opinion. If that's the way he feel about Ja, that's his personal opinion. But not me. That does that give you the right to go making songs and saying all this shit about it?
I write my life. You write what you seen in gangsta movies. I'm gangsta to the core, nigga. You can't move.
Yeah.
Not a murderer. Nah, you not a murderer, nigga. Bitch. Ja, you little stupid, little looking motherfucker.
Your boss is a bitch. If he could, he would. Sell his soul for cheap. Trade his life to be sure.
Ja's my dog, and we bang together, you know what I mean? Straight up and down, it's murder for life. I'm from the good hood, from ghetto. I came straight to Murder, Inc., straight from my cell, from jail. People see me on the sideline, and like, damn, Black been with Murder for like 4 years, was popping with Black. But now it's time for me, now that the beef is popping, you know what I mean? It's time for me to smash them. But I'm not out for the big fame, jump out there just for the chains, the jewels, and man, listen, my family got a house, I'm taking care of my family. Got something called health insurance now.
Nigga, you fucking with a thug. I'll chip slow. Flesh
out,
flesh out.
Nigga, just, nigga, yes, 7:30 entertainment.
Let me let these niggas know I ain't got to spit shit at these clowns, these fucking chumps. Word to mother, right now I'm about to go ahead and continue to make my motherfucking hits and shit and do what I do, you know, that motherfucking platinum sound, that Murder, Inc. sound. What up, Gotti?
While Ja Rule responded to 50 Cent's disses, he left most of the work to the Murder, Inc. camp.
I remember one day when I seen 50 on the Ave, that's how real it was. He was walking to a dollar cab, and I was walking to a dollar cab. I'm talking about, nigga, we going to get public transportation. And we had a conversation. I'm like, yo, listen, man, if it's a problem with Ja, just leave that alone. I'm home. I'm eating with Rule, so if you got a beef with him, not me, leave that alone, because we eating together. Because I knew about the song when he had Murder, I Don't Believe You. I knew about that before he laid there.
Murder.
Your life's on the line. Y'all niggas don't want no part of me. I'm trying to figure out how y'all started me. You gon' make it catch on.
He was like, nah, I don't got no problems with Rule. So when I heard that, you know what I mean? That was like everything in me that would tell me, yo, leave this alone or whatever, that was out the window. I was like, man, fuck this nigga. He's a clown.
In March 2000, before they ever responded on Wax, Black Child and others, including Murder, Inc. label head Irv Gotti, confronted 50 Cent at the Hit Factory, a New York recording studio.
You want to call yourself a murderer? Then you need murderers around you to make it believable.
In the fight, Black Child stabbed 50 Cent and several others.
I don't really remember who was there, you know. My memory is kind of fucked up. I smoke a lot of weed. Now, I mean, I smoke a lot of weed. It was me and a few other people. I don't even remember who was with me. It was beef, now, I mean? Beef is when you see a nigga in his fucking studio or wherever, and the nigga want to talk, and niggas was like, nah, ain't nothing to talk about, right? It's like five of us and five of them, and niggas is getting it on and fighting and bonk. Some way, somehow, the lights got hit off, and niggas was getting it on in the dark. It wasn't like nobody hit the snitch like niggas is gangster and niggas hit the switch. Know what I mean? The fucking not see nothing. It's just in the mix of it being so crowded and niggas beefing. Somebody bumped into the light switch and it got dark. That's what happened, son. Know what I mean? Because it was like 10 niggas is getting it on in the dark. One of the niggas with 50, like, yo, where the gat at? What? I just start hitting niggas, vom, vom. Cause I first thing kicked in my mind, if niggas get to the gat, one of us is dead. But I felt the gat was in the area and niggas was reaching for it. Know what I mean? And I wasn't letting nobody get to their gun to pop me. Know what I mean? So I started poking niggas straight up and down. And that's the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God.
Word to God! Fucking snitch ass nigga 50 Cent!
In the fight, 50 Cent was stabbed. And those wounds, while minor, needed several stitches. Black Child was arrested for the stabbing.
Lawyers let us know, now me niggas was pressing charges. Niggas said that I stabbed them, and then I stabbed a few people and all that. They gave a statement on me. That's the statement that's floating around that some people don't think is a real document, but it's a real document.
The source claims to have, quote, obtained and verified, unquote, these documents in its February 2003 article on Ja Rule.
What I'm holding in my hand, I'm gonna leave with you, man, is an order of protection.
Uh-oh.
An order of protection for Irving Lorenzo to stay away from Curtis Jackson. That's 50, y'all. AKA 50, AKA informant, AKA I'm telling.
In the March 2003 XXL magazine, 50 Cent claimed that the letter of protection was a publicity stunt designed to boost Ja Rule's image a week prior to the release of Rule's The Last Temptation.
You little bitch! Try to jump off like it's a promotional stunt. 7 days before your album drop, huh, you little bitch? Order of protection. From who? Who I need order protection from, nigga? Your little... Oh, man. Motherfuckers, man.
He's a clown for denying it. For denying, because, like, anybody I really want to dig is going to find out it's true. So how you going to deny a fact? I had called my lawyer and said, yo, send me a copy over them. And we started letting the copies circulate to expose what type of person this, what type of individual 50 is, because he's running around portraying a thug and all that. See, if he was rapping about club music and itchy eye, yay, and some party jump off, he'd be cool. But you can't talk like a gangster and you a snitch.
XXL also investigated the controversial order of protection and reported that neither the officer nor his precinct actually exists.
I smell pussy. Is that you, Earl?
I smell pussy.
Is that you, Jive?
I smell pussy.
Is that you, Blay?
I smell pussy.
Is that you, Ty? Y'all niggas is pussy.
If I smell pussy, is that you, Ty? And Irv, and he said Jive, and he said my name. Once he said my name, that's it. I look, come on, man, I'm from the streets. I'm not, I gotta walk down the streets. Niggas like, yo, what's up with 50 getting at you, Black? Da-da-da-da-da. Listen, I'ma get at 50. He's the real wankster.
I stab you up, don't make me gun you down. Your whole career's nothing but a publicity stunt. Until I kill you and give you the publicity you want, yeah.
Both the source and XXL's story obscure the issue. The order of protection does exist, though it's not clear it was at 50 Cent's request. Detective William Fitzgerald does exist and works out of a precinct just blocks away from the hit factory. 50 Cent maintains that the emergence of the order of protection after more than 2 years is just a publicity stunt to give Ja Rule street credibility. Also, a procedural question exists regarding orders of protection, whether they are requested by victims, like restraining orders, or issued by a judge as a condition of release on bail.
Ain't none of them niggas can't make a record that makes them relevant. Make a hit record, and then I'll go back and forth with you all day. Other than that, when I throw a blow at your punk ass, you just eat it. You just accept it. Because you ain't shit, nigga. And you starving. When I go through the hood, it's because I'm so hood. When you in the hood, it's because you stuck in that motherfucker.
Man,
I don't got nothing to say to that cat. I heard he got a new joint on the radio talking about I'm in the hood because I don't got no choice, man. I'm in the hood because I'm going to make a difference in the hood, man. Know what I mean? I don't really got nothing too much to say to him, man. Straight up, it ain't really nothing to talk about. However, whenever, whatever, man. Know what I mean? I ain't on it riding around spending my time. I ain't even going, I don't got nothing to say. I don't got nothing to say to that clown, man.
I can't say that I can resolve a situation or a beef with somebody that I can't stand this nigga. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I really, it's not no, this ain't WWL. It's not like I just got rap beef with this nigga. I don't like this little nigga. You know what I'm saying? For pretending so much, it makes me sick.
While it launched 50 Cent's career and helped sell millions of records, the 50 Cent Murder, Inc. beef has already become violent. Where will it lead from here? Will they find some way to resolve it? Or will these rappers share the fates of Biggie and Tupac and end their beefs at funerals?
For the black community especially, we have like broken families with no father, no big brothers. And so the music becomes the big brother and or the music becomes the father because you listening to all these niggas. So it'd be like Ice Cube. I grew up Ice Cube, Public Enemy, KRS-One, LL Cool J, Big Daddy Kane. All them niggas was my daddy, you know, because I ain't have none. And that's who I listen to know how to have big nuts. You know what I'm saying? Them the niggas who I gauge my nuts by. So if Cube was saying he was knocking this, you know, knocking this nigga off, and Kane was saying this and this is how you do a nigga, and LL was saying beat niggas like this, you grow up being, okay, that's fuck it. Fuck it. I got big nuts. I'm knocking niggas off. I'm not taking shit from the police. Cube told me this, the bitch is a bitch, and I'm not fucking with these hoes. You grow up and you get the lessons that you would've got from your daddy, but you're getting it from niggas, because they got it from their daddy, and they spitting the game. So the game is the music. And it's like you're paying $10 for a whole lifestyle of games.
The spoken word is very powerful. Extremely, probably the power of the universe.
Criminal-minded.
There's
a picture of him holding 9mm.
In 1986, Boogie Down Productions, KRS-One, and Scott LaRock released their debut album, Criminal-Minded. A year later, Scott LaRock was shot and killed.
When you don't use your words correctly, wisely, the results are catastrophic. And so we put out Criminal Minded. Scott gets killed. What do you expect?
Niggas getting killed in the rap game faster than they getting killed in the drug game.
As more and more artists become obsessed with their own deaths, does this obsession become a self-fulfilling prophecy?
This is my last album.
It's over, man. It's over, man.
Tupac actually believed that he would not only not be here long, he believed that he would be murdered by someone that he did not know. He believed that he would be murdered by someone who wasn't a huge, big, important person, but it would be, as he said, a nobody and anybody will walk up to him and, you know, take him out. Because Tupac believed that anybody could be touched. And by touched, he meant that's the whole point. You know what I mean? Is if you can be touched, that's it. You can be killed.
I think about Tupac Shakur. That's all he talked about. I mean, listen to his music. He talked about dying and death over and over again. And when you put it out there that much, man, you know, I think it's going to happen sooner or later.
If you speak death, it's going to end up at your door.
Any nigga that think while I'm gone, they're going to take my spot, they're mistaken. You know what I'm saying? My spot is wedged in and it ain't going nowhere. You know what I'm saying? I'm coming right back to my place. Anybody that's in it, they're gonna have to move.
Really, if you tell me, yo, such and such, yo, I heard some dudes from over on such and such said they're trying to kill you or they're gonna get at you. I'm like, so what? Tell them, come on. I ain't got no control over the situation. If I love what you say to me, fuck with my emotions where I can't go make some new music, or I can't go do nothing because I'm thinking about what you just said, I'm the idiot. Yeah, I feel like I have a purpose. I don't know exactly what it is yet. I know it's something, I'm supposed to do something positive.
While the continuing competitive rivalry in hip-hop has created some of the most exciting music and raised the level of the game, the tension between artists and their communities has escalated. Outside forces and the allure of ever-increasing financial rewards have put tremendous pressure on artists to succeed at any cost. Now is the time for leadership, and for newer artists to recognize that leadership. Now is the time for those artists who help create the culture to step up when necessary, to guide and address grievances. Now is the time to return to the original spirit of hip-hop and stop the violence. Some of the most important voices in hip-hop were killed needlessly.
Big was that, he was that guy that made it cool for you to be you. That was a major loss, man.
Voices that can never be replaced.
It was fucked up, man, that somebody that stood for so much had to die for something so small.
What will be the legacy of their deaths?
I wish that my son was here and that he could go and lie down in my bed and come out of my room and say, "Mom, what'd you cook?" I miss him. I miss my son.